Fritz. After having stared at Jayanthu for a whole minute, I could not help asking, "Are you unwell? You seem to be in low spirits today." Jayanthu quickly lost his slightly preoccupied air, gave me a boyish smile and said, "No, on the contrary, I'm feeling a lot better. This place is truly wonderful." "You have been here before. Didn't you know how good it was?" "I had nearly forgotten," Jayanthu sighed. "Now some of my memories are coming back slowly. The bungalow certainly appears unchanged. I can even recognize some of the old furniture, such as these game chairs and tables." The bearer came in with tea and biscuits on the tray. I poured. "When did you come here last?" 31 years ago. I was 6 then. We were sitting in the garden of the circuit house in Bundi. We had arrived only that morning. Jayanthu and I were old friends. We had gone to the same school and college. He now worked in the editorial division of a newspaper and I taught in a school. Although we had different kinds of jobs, it had not made any difference to our friendship. We had been planning a trip to Rajasthan for quite some time. The main difficulty lay in both of us being able to get away together. That had at last been made possible. Most people go to Jaipur, Udaipur or Chittor when they go to Rajasthan. But Jayanthu kept talking about going to Bundi. I had no objection, for having read Tagore's poem The Fort of Bundi. I was certainly familiar with the name of the place and he felt a pleasurable excitement at the prospect of actually seeing the fort. Not many people came to Bundi, but that did not mean that there was not much to see there. It could be that from the point of view of a historian, Udaipur, Jodhpur and Chittor had a lot more to offer. But simply as a beautiful place, Bundi was perfect. However, Jayanthu's insistence on Bundi did puzzle me somewhat. I learned the reason on the train when we were coming down. Jayanthu's father, Animesh Das Gupta, had worked in the archaeological department. His work sometimes took him to historical places, and Jayanthu, as a child, came to Bundi. He had always wanted to return after growing up, just to see how much the modern Bundi compared to the image he had in his mind. The circuit house were really rather splendid. Built during the time of the British, it must have been at least 100 years old. It was a single-storied building with a sloping tilted roof. The rooms had high ceilings and the skylights had long dangling ropes which could be pulled to open and shut them. The veranda faced the east. Right opposite to it was a huge garden with a large number of roses in full bloom. Behind these were a lot of trees, which obviously housed a vast section of local birds. Parrots could be seen everywhere and peacocks could be heard, but only outside the compound. We had already been on a sightseeing tour of the town. The famous fort of Bundi was placed amidst the hill. We had seen it from a distance that day but decided to go back to take a closer look. The only reminders of modern times were the electric poles. Otherwise, it seemed as though we were back in the old Rajputana. The streets were cobbled. The houses had balconies jutting out from the first floor. The carvings done on these and the wooden doors bore evidence of the work of master craftsmen. It was difficult to believe we were living in the age of machines. I noticed Jayanthu had turned rather quiet after arriving in Bundi. Perhaps some of his memories has returned. It is easy enough to feel a little depressed when visiting a place one may have seen as a child. Besides, Jayanthu was certainly more emotional than most people. Everyone knew that. He put his cup down on the table and said, "You know, Shankar, it is really quite strange. The first time I came here, I used to sit cross-legged on these chairs. It seemed as though I was sitting on a throne. Now the chairs seem both small in size and very ordinary. The drawing room here used to seem absolutely enormous. If I hadn't returned, those memories would have remained stuck in my mind forever.
Yes, that's perfectly natural. As a child, one is smaller in size, so everything else seems large. One grows bigger with age, but the size of all other things remains the same, doesn't it? We went for a stroll in the garden after tea. Jento suddenly stopped walking and said, "Deodar." I stared at him. A deodar tree. It ought to be here somewhere, he said, and began striding towards the far end of the compound. Why did he suddenly think of a deodar tree? A few seconds later, I heard his voice exclaiming jubilantly, "Yes, it's here, exactly where it was before." "Of course, it's where it was before," I said. "Would a tree go roaming about?" Jento shook his head impatiently. "No, that's not what I meant. All I meant was that the tree is where I thought it might be." "But why did you suddenly think of a deodar tree?" Jento stared at the trunk of the tree, frowning. Then he shook his head slowly and said, "I can't remember that now. Something had brought me here, near the tree. I had done something here. A European."
"European?
No, I can't recall anything at all. Memory is a strange business." They had a good cook in the circuit house. Later in the evening, when we sat at the oval dining table having dinner, Jento said, "The cook they had in those days was called Dilawar. He had a scar on his left cheek and his eyes were always red, but he was an excellent cook." Jento's memories began returning one by one soon after dinner. When we went back to the drawing room, he could recall where his father used to sit and smoke a cheroot, where his mother used to knit and what magazines lay on the table. And slowly, in bits and pieces, he recalled the whole business about his doll. It was not the unusual kind of doll little girls play with. One of Jento's uncles had brought for him from Switzerland a 12-inch long figure of an old man dressed in traditional Swiss style. Apparently, it was lifelike. Although it was not mechanized, it was possible to bend and twist his limb. Its face had a smile on it, and on his head it wore a Swiss cap with a little yellow feather striking out from it. Its clothes, especially it in their little details, were perfect. Belt, buttons, pockets, collars, socks. There were even little buckles on the shoes. His uncle had returned from Europe shortly before Jento left for Bundi with his parents. The little old man had been brought in a village in Switzerland. The old man who sold him had jokingly said to Jento's uncle, "He is called Fritz. You must call him by his name. He won't respond to any other." Jento said, "I had a lot of toys when I was small. My parents practically gave me everything I wanted, perhaps because I was their only child. But once I had Fritz, I forgot all my other toys. I played only with him. A time came when I began to spend hours just talking to him." Our conversation had to be one-sided, of course, but Fritz had such a funny smile on his lips and such a look in his eyes, and that it seemed to me as though he could understand every word. Sometimes I wondered if he would actually converse with me, if I could speak to him in German. Now it seemed like a childish fantasy, but at that time, the whole thing was very real to me. My parents did warn me not to overdo things, but I listened to no one. I had not yet been put in school, so I had all the time in the world for Fritz. Jento felt silent. I looked at my watch and realized it was 9:30 p.m. It was very quiet outside. We were sitting in the drawing room of the circuit house. An oil lamp burnt in the room. I asked, "What happened to the doll?" Jento was still deep in the thought. His answer to my question came so late that by that time I had started to think that he had not heard me at all.
I had brought it from Bundi. It was destroyed here.
Destroyed?
How? Jayanto sighed. We were sitting out on the lawn having tea. I had kept the doll by my side on the grass. I was not really old enough to have tea, but I insisted, and in the process the cup tilted and some of the hot tea fell on my pants. I ran inside to change and came back to find that Fritz had disappeared. I looked around and found quite soon that a couple of stray dogs were having a nice tug of war with Fritz. Although it didn't actually came apart, his face was battered beyond recognition and his clothes were torn. In other words, Fritz did not exist for me anymore. He was dead. And then, Jento's story intrigued me. What could possibly happen after that? I arranged his funeral, that's all. Meaning, I buried him under the deodar tree. I wanted to make a coffin. Fritz was after all a European, but I could not find anything, not even a little box. So in the end, I buried him just like that. At last, the mystery of the deodar tree was solved. We went to bed at around 10. Our room was quite a large one, and our beds had been neatly made. Not being used to doing a lot of walking, I was feeling rather tired after the day's activities. Besides, the bed was very comfortable. I fell asleep barely 10 minutes after hitting the pillow. A slight noise woke me a little later. I turned on my side and found Jento sitting up on his bed. The lamp by his bed was switched on, and in its light it was easy to see the look of anxiety on his face. I asked, "What is it? Are you not feeling well?" Instead of answering to my question, Jento asked me one himself. "Do you think the circuit house has got small animals? I mean, things like cats or mice?" "I shouldn't be surprised if it does. Why?" Something just walked over my chest. That's what woke me. Rats and mice usually come in through drains, but I've never known them to climb on the bed. This is the second time I've woken up actually. The first time I heard a shuffling noise near the window. Oh, if it was near the window, it is more likely to be a cat. "Yes, but..." Jento still sounded doubtful. I said, "Didn't you see anything after you switched the light on?" "Nothing, but then I didn't switch it on immediately after opening my eyes. To tell you the truth, I felt rather scared at first, but I did switch it on. There was nothing to be seen." "That means whatever came in must still be in the room." "Well, since both the doors are bolted from inside..." I rose quickly and searched under the bed, behind our suitcases, and everywhere else in the room. I could not find anything. The door to the bathroom was closed. I opened it and was just about to start another search when Jento called out, "Shankar." I came back to the room. Jento was staring hard at the cover of his quilt. Upon seeing me, he pulled a portion of it near the lamp and said, "Look at this." I bent over the cloth and saw tiny brown circular marks on it. I said, "Well, these could have been made by a cat." Jento did not say anything. It was obvious that something had deeply disturbed him. But it was 2:30 in the morning. I simply had to get a little more sleep, or I knew I would just keep feeling tired. And we had plans of doing a lot of sightseeing the following day. So after murmuring a few soothing words such as, "Don't worry, I'm here with you. Who knows, those marks may have been on your quilt already when you went to bed," I switched off the light once more and lay down. I had no doubt that Jento had only had a bad dream. All those memories of his childhood had upset him, obviously. And that was what had led to his dreaming of a cat walking on his chest. I slept soundly for the rest of the night. If there were further disturbances, Jento did not tell me about them. But I could see in the morning that he did not sleep well. Tonight, I must give him one of the sleeping pills I bought with me, I thought.
We finished our breakfast by 9, as we had planned, and left for the food. Our car had already been arranged. It was almost 9:30 by the time we reached. Some of Jayanto's old forgotten memories began coming back again, though fortunately, they had nothing to do with the doll. In fact, his youthful exuberance made me think he had forgotten all about it. There stand elephant on the top of that gate, he exclaimed, and the turrets, and here's the bed made of silver and the throne. Look at the picture on the wall. I saw it the last time. But within an hour, his enthusiasm began to wane. I was so engrossed myself that I did not notice at first. But while I was walking through a hall, I suddenly realized Jayanto was no longer walking by my side.
Where was he?
We had a guide with us. Babu has gone out on the terrace, he told me. I came out of the hall and found Jayanto standing absent-mindedly near a wall on the other side of the terrace. He did not seem to notice my presence even when I went and stood beside him. He started when I called him by his name. What on earth is the matter with you? I asked. Why are you standing here looking morose? Even in a beautiful place like this? I can't understand. Jayanto simply said, have you finished seeing everything? If so, let's. Had I been alone, I would definitely have spent a little more time at the fort. But one look at Jayanto made me decide in favor of returning to the circuit house. A road through the hills took us back to the town. Jayanto and I were both sitting in the back of the car. I offered him a cigarette, but he refused. I noticed a weird excitement in the movement of his hand. One moment, he placed them near the window, then on his lap, and immediately afterwards began biting his nails. Jayanto was quiet by nature. This odd restlessness in him worried me. After about 10 minutes, I could not take it anymore. It might help you if you told me about your problem, I said. Jayanto shook his head. It's no use telling you, for you're not going to believe me.
Okay, even if I don't believe you, I can at least discuss the matter with you, can't I? Fritz came into our room last night. Those little marks on my quilt were his footprints. There was very little I could do at this except catch hold of him by the shoulders and shake him. How could I talk sensibly to a man whose mind was so obsessed with such an absurd idea? You didn't see anything, didn't you? I said finally. No, but I could distinctly feel that whatever was walking on my chest had 2 feet, not 4. As we got out of the car at the circuit house, I decided that Jayanto must be given a nerve tonic or some such thing. A tranquilizer might not be good enough. I could not allow a 37-year-old man to be upset by a simple memory from his childhood, I said to Jayanto upon reaching our room. It's nearly 12 o'clock. Should we not be thinking of having a bath? You go first, said Jayanto and flung himself on the bed. An idea came to my mind in the bath. Perhaps this was the only way to bring Jayanto back to normalcy. If a doll had been buried somewhere 30 years ago, and if one knew the exact spot, it might be possible to dig the ground there. No doubt, most of it would have been destroyed, but it was likely that we'd find just a few things, especially if they were made of metal, such as buckle of a belt or brass buttons on the jacket. Jayanto could actually be shown that that was all left of his precious doll, he might be able to get rid himself of his weird notions. Otherwise, he would have strange dreams every night and talk of Fritz walking on his chest. If this kind of thing was allowed to continue, he might go totally mad. Jayanto seemed to like my idea at first, but after a little while, he said, "Who will do the digging? Where will you find a spade?" I laughed.
Since there's a garden, there's bound to be a gardener, and that would mean there's a spade. If we offered him a little tip, I had no doubt that he would have no objection in digging up the bit of the ground near the trunk of the tree at the far end of the lawn. Jayanto did not accept the idea immediately, nor did I say anything further. He went and had his bath after a little bit of persuasion. At lunch, he ate nothing except a couple of chapatis with meat curry, although I knew he was quite fond of his food. After lunch, he went and sat in the cane chairs on the veranda that overlooked the garden. There appeared to be no one else in the circuit house. There was something eerie about the silence that afternoon. All we could hear was the noise made by a few monkeys sitting on the gulmohar tree across the cobbled path. Around 3 p.m. we saw a man come to the garden carrying a watering can. He was an old man, his hair, moustaches and sideburns all were white. Will you ask him or should I? At this question from Jayanto, I asked a reassuring hand and went straight to the gardener. After I had spoken to him and he looked at me rather suspiciously, clearly no one had ever made such a request. "Why, Babu?" he asked. I laid a friendly hand on his shoulder and said, "Don't worry about the reason. I'll give you 5 rupees. Please do it as you're told." He relented, going so far as to give me a salute accompanied by a broad grin. A beckon to Jayanto, who was still sitting at the veranda. He rose and began walking towards me. As he came closer, I saw the pallor on his face. I did hope we would find at least some part of the doll. The gardener, in the meantime, had fetched a spade. The three of us made our way to the deodar tree. Jayanto pointed at the ground about a yard from the trunk of the tree and said, "Here." "Are you sure?" I asked. Jayanto nodded silently. "How much did you dig? "At least 8 inches. The gardener started digging. The man had a sense of humor. As he lifted his spade, he asked if there was a hidden treasure under the ground, and if so, whatever we would be prepared to share it with him. I had to laugh at this, but Jayanto's face did not register even the slightest trace of amusement. It was the month of October and not at all warm in Bundi, yet the collar of his shirt was soaked in sweat. He was staring at the ground unblinkingly. The gardener continued to dig. Why was there no sign of the doll? The raucous cry of a peacock made me turn my head for a moment, and in that instant, Jayanto made a strange sound. I quickly looked at him. His eyes were bulging. He raised his right hand and pointed at the hole in the ground with a finger that was visibly trembling. Then he asked in a voice turned hoarse with fear, What is that?" The spade slipped from the gardener's hand. I too gaped at the ground, open mouth in horror, amazement and disbelief. There lay at our feet, covered in dust, lying flat on his back, a 12-inch long, pure white, perfect little human skeleton.